Hi, Just. Hi, Just. Hi, Just.
Hey, good m afternoon. Good morning.
Still morning, yes.
Good morning, Salma. How are you?
Fine, and you?
I'm good. Yeah, I'm good. Yeah.
Oh,
Hey,
actually, there is a little bit of.
afternoon. Good morning.
Still morning, yes.
Good morning,
Okay.
Salma.
We
How
have
are
an
you?
Fine, and
Yeah,
you? There is
I'm
an
good.
echo.
Yeah, I'm good. Yeah. A
I.
long ago. Yeah, why is that? Good morning.
I
Still
understood
morning,
actually
yes.
because I'm
Okay,
opening
so we have an echo.
the
Fine,
YouTube. I'll
yeah.
just close the YouTube. Let's try again
Hey, we
because it's
don't
a live
record the session,
stream.
right? Because I see the recording is on, right?
Yes, the recording is on and actually it's live on YouTube. So this is why we had the echo. I think now it's good. Is it
What
good
happens
in your
with the
part?
recording?
It's still recording.
No, I
Recording here
mean,
on the
because I
Zoom.
don't like that the recordings
Ah,
are on
yeah. We
demand
will
and
not
people
share
can
it. Yes.
download and watch
So
and do
I'll
anything what
stop
they want
it.
with it.
Yeah,
Huh?
yeah. It's stopped.
Okay.
It's not recorded anymore. So we're good. Is everything good with your contract?
Yeah,
With
now everything's settled. Yeah.
okay.
I
Perfect.
think there
That's
is a
perfect.
language barrier there. But
The
I think
language, the culture, everything is
everything, many barriers.
it.
No, but no, I think no, I think that's all good. Let's see how it goes after today. But I think it is now all it's all going to work. So that's good. Yeah.
Yeah, we're very happy to have you, Jus. So thank you
Yeah.
again.
No,
It's
but it's great to be with you.
amazing and I
Yeah.
think very important to the ecosystem. So you're giving a lot
Yeah.
to our ecosystem and it's really good. And this is the kind of barriers that we need in Tunisia, actually, to make our ecosystem also very aware of the cultural differences and more of international standards. So it's
Yeah,
kind of, yeah, so
but
you are global now, so you have to manage with different cultures, different
yeah.
cultures from India. So this
Yeah,
is part of
although
the game also.
it should fit in the context of Tunisia, right? We should not all Americanize. That's what I don't like. It should be probably more than French.
Maybe not French, maybe European.
Yeah, exactly.
Make, yes,
Yeah.
because it's natural for us to go to see what's happening in France. And it gives that we need now like a frog leap. And because what happens is, okay, we're following the steps of France, and it takes like a little bit of delays because what did France 2 years ago, we're doing it right now. And I think the whole ecosystem and the whole stuff of the evolution, the ecosystems will not allow us to like to have always like 2 steps behind of what's happening in the world.
Yeah.
So we have like to stick our standards to international standards, maybe not Silicon Valley, but more of what's happening in the other European countries or Asian countries. They are doing very well and they are offering some very adapted stuff to them, like adapted programs, but still very ambitious. And so we need actually to build a new mindset and to allow us to be more ambitious and to actually to refer to other ecosystem on start on our standards other than France, who are
Yeah.
very good actually. And we're not criticizing here what's happening there, but
No,
we
I'm not
can like
either. No.
enlarge our
No,
visions,
but
you
there's
know.
more. No, but that's I think that's the beauty about working international. To see everything from different angles, right? And I think that will enrich you as an individual.
Yeah.
So yeah. Hey, you need to give me access rights or co-host right, so I can share my presentation.
Okay. Is it okay now?
Yeah.
You can share?
Yeah.
Perfect. So regarding the Startup Bootcamp connection that we started actually, so we've sent the presentation and I had few calls. But yeah. Still we don't have like formal meetings. And I think it's very important to have the meetings. Now they have like, they're very interested to see what goes with it. And I think with the end of the year and the COVID and et cetera, that we didn't get the meetings as fast as we hoped, but yeah. It will come.
Yeah. This is not good, eh? Because now you see.
Yeah, we see the two screens actually there.
Yeah, that's not what I want. Yeah.
No, it's good. So you're working on cybersecurity. You told me on which countries?
Yeah, so no, with business part of myself, we are pitching for cybersecurity training for in the Dutch Caribbean.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
This is how that's and Caribbean. And so, of course, what a lot of these countries face is high unemployment rates. And the governments think, okay, how can we put these people to work again, right? And when you think about technology as such, accelerator programs, building an ecosystem, everything you do with technology, although it's very scalable, it also attracts a lot of cybersecurity risk, right? So what you see, there's a huge demand for cybersecurity experts, or let's say starting qualifications even, but they're not enough people. So yeah. Totally lacking behind, and that's something that needs to be fixed, right? So what the government there has asked us if we can do and if we can help them with that, and we came up with a 3-month full-time cybersecurity training from zero to hero, and after that, people will move into an entry level of cybersecurity. And a cybersecurity role with the government or utility companies or with private companies. And then they can learn further, right? Yeah. So it's really an entry level. And there's a fully digital, on-demand, virtual training session. Of course, where you do that together with your fellowships in the city you are. And you can also do it from home. Particularly
it's
the pandemic.
Not about startups, it's more about job creation and
developing
the capacities of
And specifically in the cybersecurity space. But if you look at corporate innovation, it is very much technology, and there immediately have the cybersecurity, right? So the program I was managing is fintech and cybersecurity, because within financial services, it cannot do anything without cybersecurity. Cybersecurity, I always want to say, is one of these hygiene factors, right? You need to meet certain standards, and and that's important. And so now and then I do some sidetracks.
Good.
Yeah. So I thought, probably this. I can assume that you see similar things in Tunisia. That actually was the link I made, because this is not just a small idea, and this is nationwide, right? And supported. And cybersecurity, I assume you already had discussions. How do we all cybersecure everything, right? And do you want me to have a similar background?
Actually, I sent you an email with the background.
You did.
It's at your convenience. It's optional. I sent you an email like 1 hour ago.
Oh, you did. Hold on. yeah, but you send it, I think, to my... Yeah, I think I haven't checked these emails. No worries. Oh, there's an
Okay, in 1 minute we should go.
Hold on, I'm almost there. Oh, it's all right, that, yeah. Okay. Because I think it would be nice to have a similar background. Yes, open. See, this is better, right?
Yes, perfect.
Yeah, I think it's important, right? Yeah, so I will.
So much.
Let me quickly launch the PowerPoint and again.
I think one of the team is calling me, one of the team of the event. Hello? Hello? Oui, Monet. Oui, Hatay, il est midi, donc on peut aller live. Ok, super. Super. Sur Facebook aussi. Ok, ok, merci. Ok, so let's start.
Yeah, hold on. I will put my presentation on and I will just, so I will go over the presentation and then Salma, after I'm finished, I give over to you, okay?
Okay, I'll do just one very short intro.
Yeah.
And I'll give you all the space.
Excellent. All right, okay.
So, hi everyone. We're very happy to find you back after the weekend in our Monday routine ins and out ecosystem building. Today, we will jump in a call with Joost, Joost Bergen. So hi, Joost.
Hello.
Hello. So we're very thrilled to have you today to share your all your expertise and know-how. So Joost is an entrepreneur, investor, and fintech advisor. He was one of the co-founders and managing director of the Startup Bootcamp Fintech and Cybersecurity Program in Amsterdam. Is it right?
Yes, absolutely.
You've done a lot, so I had to summarize it in in only one short sentence because it can take like the all hour for to go through all your track record. So Joost today is with us for 1 hour and a half for this session. He will share key points on innovation centers and all its the key points on management and monitoring of such innovation centers. So I will not take long because all the attendants here are waiting for you. So the floor is yours, Joost, and thank you again so much for being with us today.
Yeah, and Salma, thank you for having me. So so welcome everybody. So we are Startup Bootcamp, and together with Tunisian Startup Nation, we have the vision to set up a Startup Bootcamp program together in Tunisia. And we do it around the world, and we've acquired a lot of traction actually at the moment also in the Arab world. So very thrilled to be here today with you. So did you know that 40% of all enterprises will no longer exist, right, in 10 years' time? And what we see as well that technology is eating every industry. And I think we can clearly see that of the beginning of this millennium. And this industry technology is extremely scalable. Look at the big tech, which we see nowadays. And also when we look at the total market cap of these big techs are just extraordinarily high. And even Apple reached the $2,000 billion recently. That's actually more than Aramco as its first IPO back in 2019. And when you look at the total market cap of all these companies exceeding an enormous amount of $7 trillion, which is just enormous, right? If you think about it, how big, let's say, oil companies are, who are actually in the past the largest companies out there. And when we compare the $7 trillion with another number, which is also an important number, of course, not really comparable, but still, I think, very interesting when we look at the GDPs of countries. And look here, Japan, $5.59 trillion a year. So this is market cap, it's not income, but you see the size of this technology firms and how we're eating into every industry. I think we are here in a very extraordinary time. nowadays we have the first generation that's grow up completely into the internet connected society. And of course it will have an impact because this technology, what we see, what we have, what we carry around us every day is really changing our very civilization. And we see that everywhere. And by doing that and also changing of consumer behavior also put a lot of pressures on existing business models. And I would even say business models are not even under pressure. Some business models even become obsolete. Myself, I've done a lot within the fintech world, and you see there that business models of consumer lending, banking is really heavily under pressure. And of course, when we look at the newer generations, right, let's call it the millennial lifestyle. This is a different way of living, a different way of spending, and different consumer behavior. And we as companies, as existing companies, as ecosystems, as entrepreneurs, as investors, we see we're moving towards a whole complete new environment, which also allows us, and we have to invent them also, complete new business models. And that's, I think, is very important. Open our mind to make sure we find our way and to tap into new wallets, new consumer behavior with a business model that is appealing and, of course, able to make the numbers. At the moment, we are almost in a perfect storm. How sad it is. The coronavirus is really having a huge impact on everything we do. And what we have seen is, despite, of course, the health impact it has, the economic impact it has, it also has something else. And I think that's the whole digital transformation. We see a lot of individuals, a lot of companies suddenly see each other and find themselves in a situation they have to deliver through virtual means. Look at the event I'm today, right? I'm with you guys. And that would not be the case if there probably was no coronavirus. Then probably I was there together with you in a room. And I hope this keynote and presentation I give to you today is as valuable and insightful as you would have expected also from a face-to-face meeting. But this whole coronavirus, as Sequoia, one of the largest VC in the US, really called the Black Swan, is of course almost a catalyst to change as well. So we need to reinvent ourselves, right? But still to be open and have dreams and aspirations, as you see very nicely done in this picture. Hello, everyone. I'm Joost Bergen, and I'm entrepreneur, investor, and fintech advisor. What Salma already said, I'm a program advisor for a startup bootcamp and also fintech lead, because my experience is really within financial services, not only banking and lending, but also financial service also does a lot of the plumbing in the infrastructure, right? So infrastructure to enable e-commerce, right? Which is now also, again, in this whole pandemic situation we see, is also growing and growing more rapidly as we have ever seen before. Do quite a lot of things also on an academic front, so with INSEAD and Amsterdam Business School, and also do some work with the Eurobanking Association. And I would like to say a warm welcome to everyone to our Startup Bootcamp ecosystem. Who we are as Startup Bootcamp? Now, Startup Bootcamp, we consider ourselves belong the top five global accelerators, and we have the world's largest global network of multi-corporate backed innovation programs. So we do two things. On the one hand, we help companies from all different industries in their own innovation journey, help them to innovate and stay relevant for their customer base. On the other hand, we do accelerator programs whereby companies, governmental organizations join us together to learn and to embrace new ideas from startups and helping these startups to blossom further. And our story actually goes back since 2006. And we basically have two companies. We have Rainmaking Innovation, which is our corporate innovation company. And we have Startup Bootcamp. And the Startup Bootcamp is the brand we do all this public programs with. So within Rainmaking Innovation, we also do a lot of corporate innovation, almost under the radar in stealth mode, and helping really companies to grow their own innovation calendar. And with Startup Bootcamp, we do this in much more in the public domain, which we also have envisioned with Startup Bootcamp Tunisia, but more about that later. So we consider ourselves as a partner for leading companies to solve big problems, right? And what's important there is really the entrepreneurship. And entrepreneurship means ownership. So when people take ownership, they have the willingness to change. And when you have the willingness to change, you can put something new in motion. And we do that in different phases, right? So we do opportunity mapping. So what are the opportunities out there in the marketplace? What are the opportunities for our organization as a whole? And then we do a lot of pilots, and that can be pilots out of our own organization. So ideas of people, employees that have new ideas and bring them, or we do that together with startups, which we source globally and actually map the startups with the opportunity mapping. So internal innovation is very important. What we have seen is that a lot of companies have a lot of ideas. Certain ideas will grow. Many of them will not, but a few will grow and grow. And we can even put that outside, and then we call that venture building. And you see here, we do that not only financial services, but across to many different sectors. And you also see some names of companies we still working or have worked with in the last 14 years. And this is very important for us, because this is the network we have. This is what we see in the industries, and of course also helps us with new clients and new companies, how we can help them further in their own innovation journey. Because it's really about innovation and reinvent yourself and make sure you stay relevant for your existing clients, but also for future clients. And as well, of course, also for your employees. Don't forget that employee paragraph. I will come back to that in a bit later. So that's our uniqueness, right? So we are proven entrepreneurs, and our incentive is really in alignment. And that's, I think, one of the key factors to really innovate nicely. So let's start, and let's call some numbers of Startup Bootcamp. So we have more than 900 companies scaled since year to date, and we have worked with more than 85 different partners from the Fortune 500. When we look at the companies, and we also have the 900 companies have scaled, we also have them in portfolio. We have raised more than $700 million in funding for these startups, and we have engaged with our partners in more than 300 different POCs. So a POC is really a first proof of concept of the startup with the large organization. And what I said, we do that in different categories, right? So financial service, fintech, so there's a financial service technology, very important, as well as insurance tech, but also smart cities. Cities are changing, cities are growing rapidly, right? It is predicted that certain cities, also in Africa, will have more than 100 million inhabitants by the end of this century. So we need to make the city smart to have a healthy environment and also sustainable cities for the future. Digital health, right? We see a lot in tech and health, not only on the consumer side, but also on the corporate side. Food tech, how can we produce more food on the smaller size of piece of land? How can we put more nutrients in to have a higher value of crops? So the whole food tech industry is an industry that's very important, also very much linked to the smart cities as well. IoT, Internet of Things, the connected world, machine to machine. This is something which we believe this will grow more and more and more, because it's about data, right? Because these little devices get a lot of data, and with the data, we can understand what's happening in the grid. And we see already in the electricity grid that IoT is used to measure and to understand how the grid is really doing, and where do we need to do maintenance to avoid disruptions of the grid. Transport and logistics, with more people moving to cities, with more movement also in the e-commerce space, we also have much more transportation issues. And of course, transport also has to do with pollution. So that's another side. How can you do transportation in a sustainable manner? Don't forget the whole movement to electrification. So electric vehicles in the whole transport and logistics sector. And of course, what I said, commerce, had a whole move to e-commerce, the move from both in-store as online. How do you do that? How is financial services bring that? What is consumer behavior? How are all the dots connected? So these are the industries we are mostly working in. And when we do programs, we use a framework for that. And the length of a program is a 4 months duration. And that 4 months duration will really lay down the foundation for the startups to grow into their own business models. So we will search, of course, for the startups, which fits most nicely in the objective of the program as such. And then we work with them very thoroughly through these 4 months, and we connect them to our partners, right? Not only partners in Tunisia, but also partners around the world. And that's very important, international network, because you want to break out into your own little ecosystem where you are, but that ecosystem should give you wings to move outside and to blossom further. And we are focused on industries, right? We focus very clearly on industries with where to focus on, because you can't focus on everything. We should make choices. And when you look at our whole sourcing and selection process, so we begin with a very large pool of a portfolio of potential companies, both locally and international, and we move that and actually through our whole selection process, right? We do videos nowadays, because everything is, of course, virtual. And by doing that, we move them towards the tunnel and to the final selection. And we do the final selection through a three-day selection process. We present our top companies, and then we select the best. We use exactly the same framework when we also do corporate innovation, and a corporate has a certain need to be working with or would like to use technology of startups, and we use a similar framework to fine-tune which startups are most suitable to work together with our clients, with our large corporate clients. So what you see here is actually what we do in financial services, right? So we build and work in around the world in different cities, and really with financial technology. And what we see, financial technology has really driven the game on innovation, one of the first sectors that really moved. Probably also because financial service also one of the first industries that went into technologies in the 60s and 70s. And now they have to move further. And of course, a legacy problem within financial services is quite a challenge. And when you use new technology, the question is, how well can you use the technology to improve, right? Not only improve the client journey, but also to increase operational efficiency, reduce cost. So when we look at smart city and digital health, we also do that in several cities. So you see similar cities, but we do there also very specific programs per industry for these in these different markets. And what I said, we're quite active in the Arab world from Dubai. We do different in Qatar, in Saudi, and now we have rewarded one other big project on the African continent as well. And that's what you see here, what we do in different areas in that world, and also with whom we partner. So Dubai for us is really an important hub moving into this whole region. So that's a little introduction of my side. So what I would like to discuss with you today is the following: is what is now a startup? What is now a startup program, right? Who are the actors of a startup program? And what are the benefits of a startup bootcamp program, as we have done it every year amongst 22 times a year? And we already do that for more than 10 years. So we have run a lot of programs already. And the question is, so what are the different actors, and when do you see it as a success? And I will walk you through that slowly, and after that we can have a Q&A and more dialogue together when I hand over to Salma, and then you can ask me, of course, questions. I'm not doing this alone. I'm doing it together with my colleagues Lars and Ave. We work very closely together to put everything together. And every program we run always have local people on the ground to manage it on a day-to-day business. So we have a program director, we have an operational manager, we have a lead scout, and we have a marketing manager. And this is supported by more junior or experienced entrepreneurs of the locations we are in. And of course, ourselves, and also additional support staff from our global teams. So when you look at a startup program and an accelerator program, so I think first we see a difference between accelerator programs and innovation centers of innovation programs. What I see is an accelerator program is a program to accelerate young, ambitious companies, right? For the benefit, of course, also for large corporates. But large corporates can also embed in their own organization the innovation centers, right? They do probably similar things, but they also want to be engaging with startups. So the two worlds very nicely come together in a program, right? Because we bring the whole ecosystem. And I think that's even more important of an accelerator program, as an innovation center does something for ourselves as a company. An accelerator program, as we bring them in the world, is really building a whole ecosystem. And that ecosystem consists of corporate partners, so companies or semi-governmental organizations that have a need to innovate, right? They really have a very clear innovation idea of their, these have an innovation strategy. The question very often is, how do I operationalize that innovation strategy? Startups, right? That's not a part of the ecosystem. Startups need to grow. You cannot just have your idea, develop your technology stack, and then wait and see, okay, who's going to buy it? No, you really need a very proper scaling strategy, a sales and marketing strategy. How do I do the business? So that's for startups extremely important. Another actor in that whole ecosystem are investors, because we need capital to grow the companies. And investors are always looking for interesting, valuable opportunities. So this is another thing we connect together. And then last, but probably most importantly as well, are the mentors. And that's really building an ecosystem. So when we land in Tunisia, we're looking for corporates. We're looking, of course, for startups and investors molding together. But we're building that whole ecosystem. And that's what we call our mentors. And mentors do have an interest in the journeys of startups, in the journeys of corporates, and would like to give help and handhold companies in that journey, right? And of course, nice things can happen. And a mentor can become an investor, a mentor can become a board advisor or business development person. But nevertheless, that's all in the future. For now, it is, we would like to work together and build the ecosystem further. And our initial focus is really on biotech, fintech, and the creative industry, right? From obvious reasons, of course, we can look at other areas, but I think these are three very important areas where a lot of organizations, profit and non-profit, are looking into to innovate, as well as investors do have an interest in these industries also to invest in. And when we look at this whole ecosystem, there are a few things what is always important. That's the enabling of technologies, right? A lot is said about blockchain. Blockchain, we can have a very long debate on that, but it's actually a way, how do I capture data in a certain way, right? That the tamper proof can't be changed. That's what blockchain really helps, right? So it's an extension of the database capacity we have, right? We can lock changes in data. That's the blockchain, right? Data analytics, I think that's extremely important. When we have data and databases, then we would like to use the data to do meaningful things with that and see certain trends we would never have seen before. I think data analytics as a competence is really 21st century competence. So if you are in this business, I think data analytics is extremely important. But before you can do data analytics, you need clean data, right? And to get clean data, you need to have processes and governance in place that everyone is inputting data on a similar way, or we captured or consumed data on a similar way and fill in our data lakes on such a way that data lakes will not move into data swamps. Because if you have a data swamps, we cannot do real data analytics. Another important enabler in the whole technology framework is privacy. And in Europe, you have GDPR, which is a very strong privacy legislation, which really protects the consumer and really give the ownership of his details on his privacy back to the consumer, and everyone that wants to use our data need commitment from the individual. And what we see now in different parts of the world, we see this whole GDPR legislation is getting adopted in different jurisdictions, I think, which is a good thing. And then last but not least is cybersecurity, right? So when we are in technology and when we are in scalable technology, cybersecurity, of course, is we need to be secure. We need to protect the data we have, not only from a GDPR privacy perspective, but we want to protect it anyway. And the threats are, of course, everywhere. And you can read it every day in the news as well. But cybersecurity is very important, and we need to meet certain minimal standards, right? When I do a lot of work with in the fintech space and the companies that would like to work with a bank or with other providers in this industry, they need a minimal level of cybersecurity, right? Otherwise, you're not even seen as a serious partner to work with. So cybersecurity is extremely important, and there are almost 2 million. The demand for cybersecurity specialists is 2 million higher than the capacity really is at the moment. And that gap is growing and growing. So cybersecurity is really a space for people to go into and to start and get your first credentials in that. So when we look into that and we look at Startup Bootcamp Tunisia, so we have the four actors. Let's first look at the corporate actor. Every company, if it is a financial service company or any other corporate that brings value to the whole ecosystems, they are constantly looking, okay, how do I stay relevant for my clients? And every organization, they should leverage their technology, balance sheet, and brand recognition to stay relevant, not only today, but also in the future. And we believe that that should be combined with collaboration and partnerships to innovate. Right, that's a mouthful, but I think this is what it really is all about. We need how to stay relevant, and how can we use our current assets to stay relevant together with collaboration and partnerships to be able to innovate. And what I always say, we have three different pillars actually when corporates want to innovate, right? First, we need into the organization a culture of innovation and awareness. A lot of companies don't have that. So first we have to work on that. What is the sense of urgency? Why do we move to an innovative culture and capacity? And how do we get there? The getting there is another thing. The getting there also has to do with create a place where innovation can blossom in your own organization. So set up an innovation hub, as I said. And this is all internal within organizations, right? And then thirdly, really also increase the capacity and utilize new technology to do something else and tap into new wallets or bring in new business models to stay relevant for your existing and future clients. So, and this is really about people. So to build a culture of innovation, it is about people. And people are willing to change, right? The question always is, can they really change, right? And do they have the right competences to change? And again, coming back to competences, that's first. So we need to train the people. We need to train the people to get innovation in the mindset. And secondly, the urgency, right? An organization needs to understand the urgency to build an innovation culture and to help the people, to handhold them, to move into that culture of innovation. But can organizations do that? Huh? Do we have the right competence in place at the moment? And do we really see the urgency? And there we see, of course, different paths, right? When I look myself in the financial industry, there are banks that really see the urgency. But there are also a lot of banks that don't see the urgency. And I think when you look at your own companies, you know, you will see exactly the same. Certain companies are very much moving towards innovation and otherwise really stay traditional. And we see that in management styles and the way they operate, and also that they don't see the urgency to change. But let's assume the company sees that they have to change, right? So then everyone in the organization need to give the tools and the understanding and helping them to develop themselves towards an innovation culture. And how can you do that as an organization? So what we see, a lot of companies set up then their innovation centers. And this innovation center is a physical place within the organization where employees of the organization can work together and think about radical new ideas, radical new business models. And they work on that together collaboratively to develop that further. And so it's very important as an organization to give room to breathe and really helping the big organization to change by putting little seeds in that organization. And what's there important that we connect the problem we see in our current operation and explore for new ways of tackling these problems, right? So it's really about problem solution fit. And that's what we do in this innovation ideation session, right? And the design thinking, how can we change what we currently do and improve that further? But as an innovation center, very important, you need also very tangible deliverables, right? Because that keeps up the momentum, but that also keeps up the credibility. Because many organizations are not fit, or part of the organization are just not fit for change. And they have to understand that they have to change, because what we have to do today is we have to run the company today, but also the building the company for the future. And this is a very interesting phenomenon, what you see in many organizations, because certain departments are just not fit to handle innovation. Look at the bank, look at the financial institution. We have there an execution engine. Constantly people are going to the bank to execute and make the revenues. With many other organizations and corporates, we have an execution engine. We have to make the current revenues. We have to run the business of the current organization. And then suddenly next to that, we are building the new organization. And that's what we call the exploration engine, right? And this is really that startup that innovation center that should build and should test and have innovative ideas and build these ideas further in such a way that by doing that, we build another organization next to us. And these are teams from different areas of the organization that brought in this innovation center. They work and collaborate together. They can work with tech people, operations people, but they can also work with outside startups. And there is the startup equation coming in, right? So when the organization has identified certain problems or certain things they want to improve, they can look at startups outside to help them to solve these problems. And that's also the business we are in, to make that connection. But it's really about an entrepreneurial culture, right? Where people actually take ownership for change. And when you combine the two, we have an execution engine on the one hand that has to make the revenues and the profit for today. We have the exploration engine that builds new ideas to help the execution engine further, or even build the new business models for the future. And what's, of course, here important, that we always have full support from C-level. And that's also the reason I mentioned we need tangible outcomes, because exploration engine need to show successes, right? To be able to showcase to the execution engine that we should change and we really should innovate. And what I just said, so we can develop internal ideas in our innovation center, but we also need to collaborate, right? And that's what I mean with a demand-driven corporate startup collaboration approach, whereby we have certain ideas, and we work on these ideas further, how we would like to see how that should work in our own organization. And then we're looking outside and looking for tech companies that can help us to solve this. This can be incumbent, large tech companies, but also small companies, startups, scale-ups, that have fixed that problem already, and they would like to work with you as a large organization to help you to fix that. Of course, give them the opportunity to scale their own business and give you the opportunity to get new technology in to fix your problem as well. Not only that, you also work together, collaborate with these startups, which gives, of course, a totally different mindset to this innovation center and the people that work there. What does it mean to innovate? What does it mean to be entrepreneurial? What does it mean to really think big and make radical changes? And a startup collaboration, so a demand-driven corporate startup collaboration is a cornerstone for successful growth strategy. And see here where accelerator programs, what we do in Startup Bootcamp and what we have envisioned to do in Tunisia together, how that can also help, let's say, the whole ecosystem, but also the innovation agenda of large organizations. And I'm not, yeah. So when we look at stack startups, right, and they all remain relevant, right? So so a lot of growing players in a certain industry, they engage with startups. There's a lot when you look and search on the internet, you see that, right? Successful companies, they engage with startups. Successful companies, they acquire startups or collaborate further. And I think what's important when you collaborate together, you have to, as a large company, you have to think as a startup, have the entrepreneurial mindset, right? And as a startup, you also have to think about how does a corporate work? What is the decision-making process of a large organization, right? What are all the other departments that have to say yeah to our idea, right? When you look at banking, it is about risk, it is about compliance, it is about other things that are important in their decision-making process before they can even start collaborating with you. And what's the point here? Develop solutions that help cut costs and develop new services. So operational efficiency is important because otherwise costs are growing rapidly and costs are difficult to offload. So if you have solutions as a startup that also will increase the operational efficiency or automate processes, of course, this is an important part of your solution. And what startups do, tech startups do, they address real business problems. Because very often you see the startup founding team are a group of people that have worked with large organizations, have seen how the process or the value chain is broken. And when they get outside of the organization, they think, let's build something, let's build technology that fixes that problem, right? And that's, I think, immediately also what I see as a great founding team of three people that basically fulfill these characteristics. And what's the difference between tech startups and non-tech startups? Tech startups is a business that is scalable, because today you can do something in France, tomorrow you can do something in the Netherlands where I'm from or in London, and the next day you can do something similar with a similar organization in Tunisia. So this is a scalable business. And I think that's very relevant as well. So when you look at a company and their portfolio of bets, so they have certain ideas internally growth, right, generated by the business units, so organic ideas which move from a concept, validate, pilot, and possibly even to scale. You have partnerships, so that is collaboration with startups, where you really collaborate as equals together, and sometimes you even buy a startup. And when you look at the portfolio, of course, you have a lot in concepts and a few to scale. And we help organizations in doing this, right? Not only their own ideas, but also to collaborate heavily together in the demand-driven startup collaboration. And I'm not alone here, right? So also Harvard Business Review last May actually published an article, looking to boost innovation, partner with a startup. You see here, so when you want to boost innovation, partnering with startups will bring you a lot. And what is the stepwise approach in this article? Identify the most valuable problems to solve, make potential partners aware of the problem, and match with the partners rather to cross the divided. So it is about identifying the problem, looking for the right startups, and make the match, right? Then have a contract together and then work together towards success. And that's actually what I said as well, what we do in Rainmaking and Startup Bootcamp. So this is for corporates, right? So, and I think a lot at stake for large organizations to do this, properly. So what will a corporate partner value from a Startup Bootcamp program as we have envisioned it in Tunisia, right? So what you get is high quality deal flow of startups, right? Because we don't only source in Tunisia or in the region, but global, right? So we have to identify these are the things we're looking at, and we are looking for these companies. And we see thousands of companies every year. So we know very well what companies are out there and which one are interesting. And what you also get, you get to understand new technologies and new business models, because these startups not only provide business models, very often also have developed their own technology to bring value, to run a business. So you get engaged suddenly with new technology and business models. And of course, opportunity to engage with them, conduct pilot projects, which is of course relevant for your own organization, for your innovation center, to show successes, to do projects. And of course, probably one of the most important things is that you bring innovation from external into your own organization. Because suddenly you get a set of entrepreneurs in your organization that work together with your own staff. And of course, that will have impact on each other, how we see innovation, how we want to drive change. So, and what's an important, what we see from a program point of view, what's an important that corporate partners do? Of course, collaborate with the startups, right? Do proof of concept, do pilot projects with them. Mentor possibly one or two startups as well, as domain knowledge, as an expert in your own business. Help these startups further and connect them to other companies. Probably you can even, as an organization, invest in a startup, not only do a POC and pay a little bit for it, but also do a real investments in that. And of course, the whole marketing, being seen in your own ecosystem as a company that is really in innovation, right? And really embrace innovation, the innovation mindset and entrepreneurship. So that's what I think what corporates need to do. So when you are, when you want to measure success of your innovation center, what's important, how many ideas internally have you brought to a certain level, have you really test also with technology, and how much many collaborations and POCs have you done with the external world? How many engagements did we have with startups that can really change certain parts in our own organization and their technology and mindset is meaningful to stay relevant for our own client base? So POCs, the validation sessions with real clients, these are the areas where you can also measure success, how well you do as an organization. And a startup bootcamp program in Tunisia would help you to do that, right? And to engage with these companies. So that is the corporate side. Let's look at startups as well. And let me make sure I stay in time. And if you have any questions, please write them down, because I would like to finish it and then I can show the slide again and then we can talk about it. So that's fine. So startups need to grow, right? So for a company, it's very important to have a good go-to-market strategy, right? They need to further develop their own business. And of course, they need funding, because their runway is limited, right? If you are a founding team, as already articulated, three people worked in a certain industry, in a certain business, saw that something was broken in the value chain, thought let's develop a piece of technology to fix that problem, has a cost, right? And you don't have, you only have a certain time span to do so. So what's very important, time is against you and capital is against you. So the quicker you can go to market, the quicker you have actual clients that you can send an invoice who they pay, the better it is. And but I would like to use the following metaphor. When Ernest Shackleton went to the South Pole, he put an advertisement in the local newspaper. And look at this advertisement, that this is an advertisement of a startup, because a startup journey is a rough journey as well. Look here, man wanted. For a hazardous journey, small wages, bitter cold, long months of complete darkness, constant danger, safe return doubtful, honor and recognition in case of success. And what we would like to do with the Startup Bootcamp Tunisia is help entrepreneurs in this rough journey, but help them to become successful. And what we bring as a value proposition towards startups is what you would normally do as a startup in 2 years in your acceleration is what we will do with you in a period of 4 months. And I think that's very important to acknowledge, right? So you're the time and capital is already against you. And what we do is to really push a lot of activities in a small time frame to get the wheel moving. Because the plan of most entrepreneurs is a very straight plan. This is where I want to go through. Of course, there are a lot of hurdles, right? Not even said, there can be pivots even of your value proposition, where you say, we thought we would do this, but we do something differently to make it successful. So for companies, it is really about getting the traction, get the attention, validate with companies, sell to clients, right? And when you sell to your first client, your credibility is raising. And when your credibility is raising, you can sell to others and you are seen in the ecosystem. Because what I said, time is limited. And that's what we do in this 4 months program. And in that program, we do a lot of workshop, a lot of other things, but you also get a lot of free services from these guys to help you to really accelerate, right? And that's important. That's the value we bring to startups in the program. And that's, of course, that's why we require partners, right? The partners can give you, as a startup, a smooth entry in the organization for the collaboration. And that's why we build that whole ecosystem. That ecosystem, not just for the lifetime of the program for 3 years, but it's actually there to stay, right? Because we've built that whole ecosystem, that ecosystem will move and will go further. So why are investors important? Now, what I said, capital is limited and we need capital to grow, right? Most startups, they need capital to further develop the technology stack, and the revenues received from their first clients is most often not enough to do that massive investment in the technology. So we need investors, and we need investors that believe in us. And when do investors believe in us? When we have traction. So again, that's why a program is so important. So success for a startup, right, to join a program is to have laid down the foundation, have relevant contacts and engagements with corporates to further blossom their solutions with these corporates. So that's important for them. And of course, find certain investors that have an interest in to invest in them. And why is a program as ours so relevant for investors, and why should investors join? What we do, of course, we brought deal flow, right? Investors have capital, the capital have to find certain assets, and we show them interesting assets, interesting companies where they can invest in a very diversified industry, not only locally, but global, and not only from one sector, but for several sectors we have a focus on. By providing this deal flow and jointly together with us, sourcing for the best companies out there, we also are able, of course, to identify new emerging trends. And is that technology? Is that the services? Is that certain business models? We see these trends emerging, right? And of course, that helps also to bet on the right assets to invest in. And I think our global network, what I said, we run 22 different programs, public programs on a yearly basis, and we do tens of innovation tracks with corporates. So we see a lot of that, and you become part of our whole ecosystem. What's important as an investor before you invest? Of course, do a rigid due diligence. In the 4 months period, the startup is working together with us in the program. This is, of course, a great time to dedicate time specifically to the startup, really understand who they are, who are the founders, what are their personalities, how do they work together, and do you believe they really have the possibility to accelerate and to grow? And of course, that gives you the ability to do even better due diligence and also do then the investment. So that's for the investors. And now the most important part, I think, for the whole ecosystem, and that are the mentors. So mentors are seeking for an interesting journey, and it is a mentor-driven program, right? So we have mentors, individuals. This can be individuals from that work for corporates, individuals that work for governmental organizations, individuals that just think, hey, that is cool to work with a startup. That's interesting to understand what's happening in this industry. I know this industry and have my contracts. I had my career in this industry. I'm able to help startups, and without asking anything in return. And that's important as being a mentor. And what we do with a program as such, really building that local mentor network, right? And that local mentor network, of course, is attached to our global mentor network. So you don't even have influence and insight what's happening in the program here. You can also easily become a mentor at other programs as well of your own personal interest. And magic can happen, right? And happens a lot, right? Where you mentor a certain company and there is a click between the founding team and yourself, and you can find yourself as an investor, you can find yourself as helping them in the sales and marketing strategy, you can find themselves in helping business develop certain areas. And we see many different examples of that around the globe, where mentors even become co-founders at the end of the day with them, or they just mentor and that's it. That's also fine, right? So it is in between everything. And we build this whole ecosystem of that network in Tunisia. And that's, of course, a sustainable ecosystem. It's there to stay, right? It is not just a one-day event. No, it is there to stay, to benefit from each other and to build the whole ecosystem further. So, of course, then your question is, okay, what are then success stories, right? What are the success stories with your accelerator programs? I just said what we give to the startups is what we do in 4 months is what you normally do in a 2 year period. For corporates, we say startup collaboration is your key to success for corporate innovation. So that's the link we make, and we put around that all the mentors to actually are the oil in the whole ecosystem and capital as well to make the success story even bigger. So when you see successes, Relayer, for example, that an IoT company, they were sold from Munich Re as an insurance company for 300 million. Yeah, for 300 million. They started in the accelerator program only with a PowerPoint. And that's now 7 years ago. The iTribe, they were acquired by Facebook. So a lot of companies, there's not a collaboration, but they also buy companies. And of course, it's the exit for the founding team. But when you buy it by Facebook, that's a good deal. Bellabeat, right? So they their success, they were able to sell a lot of their devices. So their business model was from technology towards operational efficiency in terms of built devices. And they were able to sell more than 100,000 in a few months' time. And so goes on and on. Here, Taspac, they were acquired by TomTom, and they also do a lot in the military special forces. Here, Trialbee, for clinical trials, right? They have received funding of 10 million from investors. 10 million is a serious amount when you're a very young company, right? Here, Quifer, more than 50 customers customers in more than 50 countries, right? Here, Mind Solution, also funding of 10 million. Authentic, so authentication of the individual in an online world is getting more and more difficult, right? So authentication, extremely important. Have your digital identity funded for 5 million. These are serious funding rounds, right? Aerobotics, 200 clients achieved in 12 months, paying clients. Important for a company to grow and to be successful and being seen as a successful story, and of course will attract more clients and also attract more capital. So that's what I wanted to share with you today. And what we really would like to do together with everyone here in the call and with Tunisian Startup Nation to really set up and make this whole Startup Bootcamp Tunisia successful journey together, where we collaborate together, not only in Tunisia, but global. And what I said, so we're looking for initially for a 3 years program, where we, in these 3 years, we do 4 cohorts, every cohort approximately 10 startup teams, and every startup team will be there for a period where we help them to accelerate. And what you see here in the different industries. And as I said, we're also looking for corporate partners, right? So if you are a corporate and you would like to join this journey with us, please let us know. And please contact me on this email account or even find me on LinkedIn, and we can discuss that further. And Salma, we have worked on this for the last couple of months already a lot together. But over to you now, and then let's open the floor for questions.
Thank you so much, Just. It was an amazing session. So that you navigated us through all your programs and Startup Bootcamp. And it's really interesting to see all the different aspects that you cover with the Startup Bootcamps, with the four like users, with the corporation and then startups and investors and mentors. So we have here many questions, actually. They sent me the questions directly on my personal messenger. So I'm trying to read from them and summarize it. So for the big corporation getting into the innovation ecosystem. So actually you've put here a finger on one like a challenging situation, because we'd like to see more corporation in Tunisia involved in the innovation and given like believing more or trusting more the startups in bringing so innovative solutions. So you used one term that had like attracted the attention of a lot of the attendees. It's the urgency. So how do we like maybe how we can work on that sense of urgency with the corporation?
Now let's put that slide on. I think that will so that's what I hear, to provide ongoing value to its clients, right? Do you see it? Yeah. Oh, it is paused. So like probably it's best to provide an example. When we look at banking services and banking service across, a lot of banks, they work through branches, right? Which is of course a business model that was working in the past, right? Because everyone had to go to the branch because you need to get your funds out, right? What you earned, even if you have earned and we're still have countries, people receive notes and coins. But nowadays more and more becomes electronic money. So the need for branches becomes lesser and lesser, probably for the older generation, but definitely not for the younger generation. What we see now is an emerging of a lot of these neobanks, right? These challenger banks, as we call them, which don't bank out of a branch, but bank out of your mobile. So there's a totally different business model. What we also see that large banks, for example, DBS out of Singapore, they have two business models. They have the traditional bank, branch banking, and they have the digital bank. When you look at the cost income ratio, whereby how much euro cent of dollars or euros do I have to put in to make 1 euro of revenues, it's extremely high with traditional banking, almost 70%, right? When you look at digital banking of the same bank, there's only 30 cents. So you already see, not only in terms of cost base and also therefore in revenue base and margin basis, but digitalization of your business is required to meet also your financial ratios. But more importantly, you can also tap into new customer demands, right? And that's what you see, I think, with many different industries where customer behavior is changing. And not only that, look at a lot of the food processing companies, right? Their research and development departments are huge. Most of these guys, where we have worked with at least, they say, we see our research and development not so much more as an internal activity. It is an ecosystem of a lot of small companies that do their own research and development. And that's actually the sourcing we use for our own new innovative launch of products. And we collaborate and work together with them. So it's almost like an outsourced research and development. So these are two examples of two different industries where you see innovation is important. It is not just to innovate. It is not about building an app. The app is an enabler to enable change. It is really about what is the customer behavior changing, right? We see it now in South Africa, right? Where a lot of people that move to South Africa also due to the crisis are now sending funds and also consumer goods to the family in other countries. Borders are closed, but it's now driven through electronic means, huh? And not anymore with physical movement of cash or physical movement of products. No, I order my goods for my family for in Zimbabwe out of South Africa with my phone in my hand. So we see new business models are emerging and it goes extremely quick. I think a lot of businesses we see nowadays flourishing they didn't exist 5 or 10 years ago. Is that an answer on the question?
It was about the urgency for corporation to enhance or to...
If you don't do it yourself, the others will do it, right? Or you get even what you've seen in the banking industry. You see a lot of new challenger banks popping up that are able to provide provide a proposition that will resonate with, let's say, the younger type of clients.
Yeah.
So we used the word in the past, disintermediation, but I think that retro term still exists, right? There are other companies emerge suddenly and they do better than yourself, and their cost base is much lower. They're much more agile, much more entrepreneurship. So that's the sense of urgency. And if you haven't recovered yourself, you have to do a research for yourself and really see, okay, let's do a disruptive analysis. What is eating our cake and what should we do?
Yeah, so you bring me to another question, actually. If we had to pitch open innovation or buying from startups or partnership with startups to big corporation, what should be actually on the pitch? So what should we sell actually to corporation to make this work and to create that sense of urgency to open the doors to startups?
Now, firstly, it is that C-level need to understand the sense of urgency. So how do we do that? We do sessions with them, executive sessions with them, where we show what's happening in their own industry to build up that sense of urgency.
Mm-hmm.
Then secondly, we have to identify the areas where we would like to innovate with or for what, right? Mm-hmm. After that identification, we start working with own people to work on that further, and then also engage with the outside world, with startups, not only for their way of, not only for their value proposition, but also for their way of working, to bring that entrepreneurship mindset and an innovative mindset in the organization, to plant the seeds in the organization to further come up with that innovative culture, because that's lacking very often.
Perfect. So I shout out to the executive session that has to be like maintained between the startup support organization and the corporation. I think this is a good idea, and we hope that we see more of it between the two. The second question actually is getting back to investors.
Yeah.
So the question is how you manage the deal flow with the investors. It is an automotive like process with the demo days or with sharing your lists with the investors, or it's more on demand. So with any of the investors in the ecosystem that is like reaching out to you to have such a number or such criteria of startups.
Now let's make it very concrete. In the program as such, right, we have of course our we do a reach out to the whole ecosystem. We do our search towards companies, and we have several hundreds of companies that are appealing. And of course, then we fine tune further in that funnel, depending on the demand. Mm-hmm. And then we also do reach out to investors. What are the companies you have an interest in to invest in? What are their characteristics? Which sector are you looking for? Which other investments have you already done? Because very often, if you have already done an investment in company A in a certain industry, you don't want to do a second investment, right? So that's a dialogue. So it's always a dialogue. It is always about collaboration. And in the program as such, we do investor pitches. So we have, let's say, 5, 6, 7 different investors who are most vocal, most interested in the cohort. And then the companies do investments. And then the investors help them to fine tune the pitch as well and help them to improve their investors deck, to make them investors ready. Because that's very important.
Perfect. So this question, I think I know the answer, but I'll ask it to you. So a startup bootcamp is lying on an equity business model, or what is your business model?
Say that again, Onan.
The question is startup bootcamp lying on an equity business
model? Yeah, yeah.
What is the business model?
Yeah, so... when you look at us, when I look at ourselves, we are actually acting as the vehicle that orchestrates everything. And we can do that on two different angles. we can charge a fee to orchestrate that, or we also take a bet in the success, and then it becomes an equity-driven program. And actually the startups we select, we take an equity stake in them for them to get into the program. So then we become actually their first investor into their company and helping them further to make sure they grow further. And that, of course, has an interest on both sides, because as we also become equity holder, of course, we have a huge interest to grow them further as well, right? Together with our partners.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Question four is, this one is a startup founder. He's asking this question and he's saying, do you think global investors are ready to invest in Tunisian startups? And what it takes to make Tunisian startups appealing or attractive to global investors?
Yeah, so I would rephrase that question. So when do we become ready as a startup for global investors? That, I think that's first. Mm-hmm. Secondly is, I think for your first round, you should probably look at local investors, tap into local investors. So that's why a program as such is also extremely important, to allocate capital to the ecosystem and to make sure we have local investments. With this local investment, you can grow the business, and then for your second investment round, you're going abroad. And then you have proven track record in-house, and then you move to investors externally. For example, I'm working at a company at the moment. It's an Italian company. And we all know, right, we have the southern part of Europe and the northern part of Europe. So northern investors don't want to immediately invest in certain part European startups. So if they have received funding in the first round from, let's say, local investors, and they grow and they also find clients in other parts of Europe and have a more diversified portfolio, then they become also more appealing for international investors. So it is really about your client portfolio and your how diverse your client portfolio is to become attractive.
Perfect. I think it's clear for, he knows himself, the one who's asking.
Good to hear.
Fifth question is, this one is referring to the mentors. So yep. You've been talking about, you've presented global and local mentors. And the question is, what's the difference between managing local or international mentors networks? So what's the difference between both of them? Do you manage them separately?
No, so the mentors in all our ecosystems, what I said is a very important asset, because it is giving something without asking anything in return as being a mentor. Mm-hmm. And of course, we select the mentors, we train the mentors to become a mentor in the program and helping startups to mentor them. But initially, of course, it is a local mentorship. These are people with boots on the ground in Tunisia, right? Because that's where we would like to grow the business further. But what I said, we have programs all over. And of course, we have ecosystems of mentors. Mm-hmm. So when you are as a mentor, also see suddenly, hey, wow, that's an interesting program in wherever we do the program. I also would like to mentor there. And then you can become a mentor of that. And in the world nowadays, but also in the past, many of the things were physically. Nowadays, it's always virtually, right? So myself, I even mentor a program in Singapore on educational tech. So that's, yeah, of course, you have to move into the way that it can also be virtually. But in our programs, we always do mentor and meeting startup sessions, and that's all virtual, also for people to be able to mentor who are not, let's say, just a mile away from the location.
What's the kind of mentorship you offer to the startups? So the typical like journey for a mentorship, mentor, startup.
No, that's between the startup and the startup and the mentor. So as a benchmark, we think for every startup, they need to reach out to different people. So within all the engagements we do, of course, they meet people. And also with the selection days, they meet people. But I think it is good for a startup to have to start with five mentors and have a dialogue with them and see how they can help them. Because it gives fresh ideas, right, on the table, as well as connections to the local ecosystems to explore further together. I think that's the whole purpose of a program, and also for startup founders. What you do in the period business is what you normally can do in 2 years. You really lay down the foundation to build on further. And suddenly you have five close friends, ambassadors even of your business, that can help you further to grow. And of course, it depends on the founding team, what they need, right? If they won't have access to other clients, then it is access to other, to new clients. It's more technology, it's more technology. Or it is more managerial, that's another thing, right? Can also be, so these are different angles, and that depends really on the founding team. What they see is they want to be mentored on, or they need an hand on, basically. Yeah.
And do you have a pool of coaches, or it's only mentors?
No, so the mentors are, let's say, local people from Tunisia, but we train them in mentor training programs where we help them to become, how to become a mentor, right? Mm-hmm. A mentor is not someone that tells a startup you have to do this.
Yeah.
Right? As a mentor, you put yourself in the shoes of the founding team. Say, okay, what's important for them? And of course, as a founding team, you receive several points of view, and then as a founding team, you decide what fits best for us, right? What fits best for purpose. And so we coach the mentors in that activity.
Perfect.
So that probably good to understand. So also so it's not only the mentors as individuals. Mentors can also be from the corporate partners, people that work for an organization, and part of the to get innovation within the organization, also to mentor startups, not only work with them in POCs or activities, but also mentor them and bring that experience back to your own organization. Of course, that will further create that innovative culture.
Perfect. And for you, so to summarize all of this, for the startup support organization here in Tunisia, there are a lot of really amazing startup support organization with great purposes and visions for the startups in Tunisia. If you had one advice for them to perform and to be like to give that added value expected by startups and to make all the ecosystem grow, what should be like three advices?
So advice is for to make it happen, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. To make it happen and to perform, actually.
Yeah. So to get it from off the ground, right? So to really get it off the ground. So what's important is that there are few companies that stand up and say, we would like to support this whole vision, right? And we would like to put not only our people to work on that, but also some capital to make it fly. And I think that's very important, because that's the first seed we put in the ground to build that ecosystem further, because that gives us the room to really build it, right? And to really engage with startups, engage with mentors, and build that ecosystem. So corporate partners is very important, and access to the mentors is very important. Mm-hmm. And then thirdly is the investors, right? That we have capital or venture capitalists or investors or a corporate venture capitalist, so the venture capitalist of companies who are all aligned in that ecosystem. Yes, we would like to make that, and then we will bring the startups. That's what we do, and we will mold everything together with all the actors, but most importantly, of course, with the corporate partners. Yeah.
Okay. I guess it's a wrap. So thank you for
any more questions?
I think no, I don't have any more questions. So thank you so much. I am telling so the attendees expect just for another session. I think next week.
The 14th.
The week after, yes. So it's the future of startup supporter organizations.
Yeah, then it will much. COVID, yeah.
Yes, with this COVID crisis and how we have to reinvent ourselves and to reimagine the ways where we are all working, actually. So we're very happy and we're looking forward already to this.
Okay, great.
Next sessions. And thank you so much for your time. It was always a great pleasure and a lot of lessons learned and you shared with us. So thank you so much, Jules.
Okay, thank you, Salma.
Thank you. Bye. Bye-bye.